that is coming for the heart that holds on. A glorious light beyond all compare. And there will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, we'll lift and know you here on the earth. And I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. And if my God is with me,
but I have sure faith that I will experience the Lord's goodness in the land of the living. Welcome to this service of worship. We're glad that you're with us. We have a few things we want to note for you before we continue in earnest. First, protection. We pray for God's protection, and we should. And we justifiably ask for God's traveling mercies, for interventions, for help. As children of God, how often do we embody these things, though, for others? How often do we offer protection or traveling mercies or interventions for those around us? How do we know that when God is answering someone else's call for help, someone else's prayer for help, that God isn't sending us? Think about that as you move through the week. We also want to make you aware that you can sign up for the weekly update, which is our church's version of basically a digital newsletter. And this is a way for you to keep up with what's going on in the church, what's going on with our folks. And so if you're interested in that, please do contact the church office to be put on the list to either receive the weekly email blast that goes out, any bereavement notices, any special event notices that go out that way. You can also receive hard copies of these things in addition to the service plan itself by regular mail. And again, you can just sign up for that and we'll send it right out to you. Of course, all of these things are available to you from the church website. So again, contact the church office to receive the weekly update and to keep up with what's going on in the community. Now, with all of that in mind, let us take a deep breath, silence our devices, and continue in worship.
Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. And even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back, I know you are near. And I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. And if my God is with me, whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear? Oh no, you never let go, through the calm, through the storm. Oh no, a light that is coming for the heart that holds on. A glorious light beyond all compare. And there will be an end to through these troubles, but until that day comes, we'll lift and know you here on the earth, and I will fear no evil, for my God is with me, and if my God is with
faith, we come to confession not to wallow in our own guilt. Instead, we come to confession because we know that transformation starts with being honest. So, in a desire to become who we are meant to be, let us pray to a God who loves us like a mother hen. Let us confess our sins together. Lord, when the Pharisees tried to stop Jesus, Jesus said, "I will keep on. I will keep on healing. I will keep on teaching. I will keep on preaching. I will keep on flipping the tables of injustice. I will keep on treating every person like a child of God. I will keep on believing that this world can change. I will keep on and keep on and keep on until God's promised day. Forgive us, God, for the times when we stop." Thank you for listening, God. Amen. soften the blow, cushion the landing, numb the surface, kill the pain, calm the waters, avoid the trouble, smooth it over. You know, there are a million ways to say it, but it seems like the goal of our culture is in conflict with the way life actually is. I mean, take vaccines, for example. I mean, the way they work, they actually make your body sick on purpose so that your immune system strengthens and produces what it needs to fight off the real disease giving us trouble. Now, that makes it sound like the way to fight disease is to go looking for trouble. Or look, take sports, for example. When I joined the wrestling team, conditioning was central to our success as a team. I mean, the more we ran in soccer practice, the more we ran circles around our opponents, the more stretches we did before a football game, the better protected we were at the bottom of the pile of players. Looking for trouble for our muscles, for our lungs, for our feet, enabled us to do amazing things and to have a lot of fun in the process. You know, even in our relationships, pain and discomfort are important parts of learning how to be in community. I mean, if there's never any friction, if there's never an argument, how do we ever learn what's important to one another? How do we learn how what we do or don't do, what we say or don't say, can affect someone else? Only if, in a way, we go looking for trouble with each other. You know, one of the real pitfalls of social media, of course, is a phenomenon that I've heard called being Facebook brave. It's when someone will post something that they wouldn't necessarily say in person or haven't said in person. Interacting can be perilous and tenuous, and so social media provides a way to get it all off your chest with little consequence, right? But there are consequences. I mean, that's the rub. I mean, we get numb to them because we don't actually see them or hear them or feel them when we post something. I mean, look, in the end, our culture still plays into this. And it's all part and parcel to the idea of sustaining as little discomfort, as little pain, as little change as possible. This way of thinking plays into the problem that Jesus is identifying with his brief but really important history lesson that we find in Luke chapter 13, and this is verses 31 through 35, Jesus' lament over Jerusalem. Listen for the word of God to us all. At that time, some Pharisees approached Jesus and said, "Go, get away from here, because Herod wants to kill you." Jesus said to them, "Go tell that fox, 'Look, I'm throwing out demons and healing people today and tomorrow, and on the third day I will complete my work. However, it's necessary for me to travel today, tomorrow, and the next day, because it's impossible for a prophet to be killed outside of Jerusalem.'" Jerusalem, Jerusalem, "you who killed prophets and stoned those who were sent to you, how often I have wanted to gather your people just as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you didn't want that. Look, your house is abandoned. I tell you, you won't see me until the time comes when you say blessings on the one who comes in the Lord's name." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So, okay, Jesus is warned, stay away from Jerusalem. And it's not just that somebody might beat him up. The governing authority wants to kill him. The religious authority, the religious leadership wants to kill him. Jesus is defiant before beginning his observation of history. Jerusalem has a habit of killing God's spokesperson. And it's ironic, right? I mean, the people of God don't seem to like being told that they're not behaving as the people of God. Herod's trouble with Jesus isn't that he's healing people or feeding people or even teaching people. He doesn't care about that stuff. He cares very much about being called out on his behavior, which, by the way, is why he had John the Baptist arrested. earlier. Now, here's Jesus expanding his influence and undermining Herod, at least in Herod's mind. Jesus is messing around with the proper order of things, and Herod's not the only one who feels that way. The religious leadership has been stirring things up against Jesus, and there's no reason to believe that they weren't doing that with Herod also. The Pharisees warning Jesus probably thought that this was their way of controlling Jesus and preventing him from changing things any further than he already had. And then Jesus starts talking about chickens. It can be easy to dismiss Jesus' analogy as premonition, that he's grieving that they didn't get that he himself was the Messiah. Yet Jesus isn't just talking about himself. He's not even just talking about Jerusalem. Yes, look, chickens are something else, right? I mean, even though they get a bad reputation for being afraid, you've heard, don't be chicken, they can be quite fierce when protecting their young. In fact, according to Neil Armitage, a hen that is being protective adopts a particular stance with all her feathers fluffed out and her wings out to the side to make herself seem as big as she possibly can. She will also spread her tail and growl loudly while gathering her chicks behind her. God has always wanted good things for God's people. God has always wanted good things for all people. God chose Israel in order to bless the whole world. God is so intent on this that God provided everything we could possibly need, including Jesus himself. You know, the author of Psalm 27 writes a veritable autobiography of God's goodness over his life, proving this point. I mean, listen here to the entirety of Psalm 27 and see if you can pick out yourself in the things that the psalm writer said that King David writes. Listen to this. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Should I fear anyone? The Lord is a fortress protecting my life. Should I be frightened of anything? When evildoers come at me, trying to eat me up, it's they, my foes and my enemies, who stumble and fall. If an army camps against me, my heart won't be afraid. If war comes up against me, I will continue to trust in this. I have asked one thing from the Lord. It's all I seek, to live in the Lord's house all the days of my life, seeing the Lord's beauty and constantly adoring his temple. Because God will shelter me in his own dwelling during troubling times. God will hide me in a secret place, in his own tent. God will set me up high, safe, on a rock. Now my head is higher than the enemies surrounding me. And I will offer sacrifices in God's tent, sacrifices with shouts of joy. I will sing and praise the Lord. Lord, listen to my voice when I cry out. Have mercy on me and answer me. Come, my heart says, seek God's face. Lord, I do seek your face. Please, don't hide it from me. Don't push your servant aside angrily. You have been my help. God who saves me, don't neglect me. Don't leave me all alone. Even if my father and my mother left me all alone, the Lord would take me in. Lord, teach me your way. Because of my opponents, lead me on a good path. Don't give me over to the desires of my enemies. Because false witnesses and violent accusers have taken their stand against me. But I have sure faith that I will experience the Lord's goodness in the land of the living. Hope in the Lord. Be strong. Let your heart take courage. Hope in the Lord. Again, the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So look, for all the emphasis that we tend to put on heaven and the hereafter, here you have in this psalm, David talking about the present. I mean, what does he say? But I have sure faith that I will experience the Lord's goodness in the land of the living. It's a fancy way of saying right now, not just in the hereafter. And so God's goodness isn't just for later, it's for right now. And God offers it freely. So why would Jesus say to Israel, to Jerusalem, to us, but you didn't want that? How can that be? You know, the author of this psalm, for all the praise and acknowledgement of God's provision, even knowing the path for this provision, right? He says, Lord, teach me your way. He walks away from God's word and protection, God's wing. And famously, for all the protection and provision that God could offer, it wasn't enough for King David. I mean, despite being the boy who conquered Goliath, his episode with Bathsheba, just for starters, would see a coup on his rule from his own son and treachery marking every level of his kingdom. I mean, why wouldn't he stay under God's wing? You know, I think about my own life, right? When I've asked for God's help and I've asked for God to intervene in a situation only to find myself trying to do things my own way anyway. You know, I hand it over to God, but then I take it right back again. I mean, I think there were times when God's way was at odds with my own judgment and perception. You know, I could just hear myself. God could ask me to love my neighbor all God wants to, but if they hurt me, they're going to get it. But, and you know, I think about Herod and the rest of the leadership in Jesus' day, how they understood things to work a certain way. They equated their way of doing things with God's will because they figured, hey, we're God's chosen, so why not? And they did so with the virtuous notion that they were protecting their interests, God's interests in their minds, from the Roman occupation. And in order for the changes that God wanted to enact to make sense, they needed to still be in power. They needed to still be in charge when all was said and done, since they were Israel. The things that they wanted equated with what God wanted, but that wasn't so. I mean, like their forebears, they missed what God was showing them. They missed how important it was to live as instructed, caring for the least. And in trying to protect their interests, they missed the protection that God was already offering. You know, back in the day, it was well accepted that if you did bad things, okay, but if bad things happened to you, rather, it's because you did something wrong. And, y'all, we still think this to a degree, even though our own life experience tells us otherwise. I mean, really, as you look at your own life, can you honestly say that every good thing that you have is a direct result of you, your actions, your ingenuity, your creativity, your prowess, your endurance? I mean, we readily say, oh, but for the grace of God go I, but what does that mean in a culture that prizes self-sufficiency and self-reliance and self-determination above all else? Is there really room in our self-identity to be hiding under God's chicken wings? Now look, part of the answer to that question is how readily we embrace God's will. And before you get excited, look, I know, okay, you're perfectly willing to do what God wants if God would only make it clear, right? That's the real question, isn't it? How are we supposed to know what God's will really is? Well, earnestly, I don't think it's anywhere near as mysterious or as complicated as we make it out to be, okay? I mean, to know what God's will is in any situation or circumstance, you only need to do three things, okay? You need to have patience, you need to love your neighbor, and you need to remember that God loves you. Now, you'll notice that I didn't mention know your Bible. Of course you should do that. I mean, scripture is a key element in building faith, but like the devil quoting scripture to Jesus in the temptation story, scripture can be abused and misused. I mean, how do you cut then through the nonsense? Well, first of all, have patience. God is not answering only your prayer. intervening only in your life or trying to bless only you. God has an entire world to manage, and like the blessing to Abraham, God's blessings come with freight. They're usually meant for more than just you. Remember, God deals in abundance. So wait. Wait for God's will to emerge and to form and to be set in motion. Have patience with the fact that sometimes God delays answering, and sometimes the answer is no. Timing is very important to God. And as always, Jesus says that that timing belongs to God alone. That's why people who say they know exactly when Jesus is coming back are lying. So if you want to know what God's will is, just wait. That's the first thing. Now, the second thing is love your neighbor. Look, everybody knows the first law is love God with basically everything that defines your life. Great. But the chief expression of this love is how we love our neighbor. If the thing you're considering doesn't involve loving your neighbor in some fashion, you may need a different approach. And look, just naming whatever you feel like doing, loving your neighbor, you know, it doesn't necessarily make it so. You've got to spend time actually getting to know your neighbor and to do things that they would actually consider loving. It's impossible to love someone well if you don't know them well. In other words, if in doubt, see rule number one about patience, about taking time. Now, look, that's rule one, rule two, right? Rule one, have patience. Rule two, love your neighbor. Rule three, again, is remember that God loves you. Now, this may seem obvious, especially to someone who may have grown up in a loving home or with a loving church, but when we face impossibly hard, tragic, transformative circumstances and situations, it can be difficult at best to remember. When we find ourselves on the defensive, it can be difficult to remember. When steeped in the anxiety that circumstances like the war in Ukraine or the Middle East or our own politics at home or the own politics within our homes, all that that can foster, it can be hard to remember God loves us. But okay, so what? Why is remembering God loves us so important to understanding, to knowing God's will? Well, because it empowers us to keep rule number one. It's amazing what we can get used to. When properly motivated, with the right frame of heart and mind, we can normalize just about anything. I remember when they were first talking about doing the surgery for my foot 2 years ago. They said that recovery could take up to a year and that I might not drive until at least 6 weeks or so afterward. Now, 2 years later, I'm only just now confident that walking again is a more permanent part of my life. Along the way, I had to manage my expectations. You know, Greg Massey talks about the first time he was in the middle of a fire. And many fires later, he actually feels peace in the middle of fires. He trusts his equipment. He trusts his fellow firefighters. Along the way, he had to manage his expectations. And they changed. And y'all, this can work the other way also. I mean, really, we stopped being disappointed in the corruption of our political leaders a long time ago. We almost equate politicians with lying. Along the way, we managed our expectations. You know, more than 6 million people that we know of have died from COVID in the world, with more than 900,000 of those right here in the United States. But we are numb to those kinds of numbers, at least until they hit us more personally. Because along the way, we managed our expectations. It just doesn't blow us away anymore. I mean, you get the idea. things get into a routine, they get into a certain kind of order, they feel like everything's under control. You know, in the movie The Dark Knight, the villain, the Joker, turns to an injured Harvey Dent and he tells him this. You know what I noticed? Nobody panics when things go according to plan, even if the plan is horrifying. If tomorrow I tell the press that like a gangbanger will get shot or a truckload of soldiers will be blowing up, nobody panics because it's all part of the plan. But when I say one little old mayor will die, well, then everyone loses their minds. I mean, what is he getting at? They expect the gangbanger to die because of his life choices, presumably. Soldiers, while their deaths are tragic, they know the risks of serving. But a mayor shouldn't go into the job expecting to be systematically killed by a maniac. Expectations rule not just our thinking, but our ability to react and respond. Look, Jesus dealt with this too. It makes me think of the story of the woman caught in adultery in John chapter 8, verses 1 through 11. There she is, dragged in front of Jesus and the crowd he was teaching. There was no doubt as to her guilt. She was caught in the act, apparently, and it was natural for the leadership and the crowd to condemn her. Although I still wonder why they didn't drag out the guy. But look, condemning her was the order of things. It was right. The crowd, they all felt justified in their ill treatment of her. She deserved it. It was expected. But God's mercy requires something more. God's mercy moves beyond our expectations. Jesus didn't condemn her like he was supposed to. He chastised the crowd instead on their self-righteousness. You know, there was another time when the Pharisees, the leadership, demanded a sign from Jesus proving his authority to be doing all these things and to be saying that he's the Messiah. And Jesus only offered them the sign of Jonah, a story about the Jews getting God's grace really wrong. And now he's about to enter again into Jerusalem. And again, Jesus is not doing what's expected. He's not going according to plan. I mean, at the news of Herod's threat, he should have gone on the run. With all the pressure his team, his tribe, his people were under with the Romans, he shouldn't be criticizing them, right? Well, okay, great. Look, that's all fine and well, but what does any of that have to do with God's will and God being our refuge? Well, y'all, it's because knowing God's will helps us to be brave. Because knowing God's will helps us to have perspective. Because knowing God's will helps us to have hope. Knowing that God loves us helps us trust God with our futures and our present. Loving our neighbor helps us to understand God's plan for all of creation. And both of those activities help us have patience for God's plan to unfold. This is all really important to cutting through a really big lie about how God's protection is supposed to work. And look, don't get me wrong. I personally experienced God's healing, God getting me out of a jam, God keeping me from getting hurt. I've experienced God giving me the words for a hard conversation and blessing my mind to know what to do about something. I've even watched God fix a situation that I messed up. And yes, God did all those things because God loves me. Absolutely. But God doesn't love only me. The lie that gets told is that God's protection, okay, means that if we're living right, we won't get hurt, we won't lose our stuff, we will be impervious. God's protection means that the things that confound and conflict with us, the things that beat us down and try to subdue us, the situations and people that cause us to fear do not have the last word. And just because of the way God works, God's protection doesn't just help us as individuals. It helps all the people touched by us. You know, it's a great thing. It's great that Greg comes to a place of peace with fighting fires. But that peace doesn't just benefit Greg. It benefits all those served by his skill putting out fires. And it's great that my foot is healing. But that healing doesn't just benefit me. It benefits Mandy as she anticipates her shoulder surgery. It benefits the people I could finally help drive to their appointments. It benefits Annie, who might not have been served by my injury. When we are blessed as a church, it should reach far beyond us. That means having patience when things don't go our way. Patience to see how God's grace unfolds. It means loving our neighbor even when it's not clear what we're getting into or when our commitment will end. By the way, God's love and mercy aren't supposed to have an expiration date. It means that remembering God loves us empowers us to be brave in the face of the many challenges before us. God's protection means we get through the hard times, not out of them. That is why Jesus enters Jerusalem. Instead of running away, knowing what is coming, this is why David can speak of hope despite all the trouble his own sins have placed him in. This is why we can count on God to be our refuge, not against our enemies and our challenges, not only against our enemies and our challenges, but even against ourselves. Because y'all, God is our refuge against the things that confound us. And God also helps those affected by our sins. So let us be patient. Let us love our neighbor, and let us remember that God loves us. In the name of the one who keeps us. Amen. Let us sing together. Time of prayer. Let me remind you that during the middle of the prayer, there will be an opportunity for you to fill in the blanks, if you will, with your own prayer concerns, your own joys, your own names, your own situations. So please do make the most of that opportunity when the time comes. The Lord be with you and also with you. Let us pray. Merciful God, how majestic is your name in all the earth. How marvelous is your goodness to us, and how plain your love is demonstrated day after day after day. I mean, what can we say but thank you? What can we do but follow you? And yet we aren't robots. We don't get programmed and then we move around on automatic pilot. You made us partners in your ongoing act of creation. You made us children through Christ, and you are transforming us more and more into your people every day. But it's hard to see sometimes. It's hard to know sometimes. And while we acknowledge that our own choices can get in the way of your will for us, Lord, a lot of stuff happens to us. I mean, we keep praying for an end to the pandemic. And we pray especially for an end to the suffering of so many to the virus's effects. Lord, may the transmission rate continue to decline and to clear. And thank you for making our in-person fellowship and worship together happen. We continue to grieve the invasion of Ukraine and loss of life and those already displaced from their homes. And while this is happening to a large European country, we also know that wars and atrocities are happening in other places as well. Intervene, O God. May your spirit come against the evil we see and hear about. Help us as a world, but especially as a community of faith, know how to respond. Thank you for mercy and love that gives us courage. Thank you for not leaving us alone, ever. Thank you for surrounding us with your peace. And help us learn to see your history with us and to trust you better. And so, Lord, we pray for so many in our community who are sick, shut in, and in rehab. We pray, we think of those on our public and private prayer lists. We pray for those who've experienced such losses. Lord, intervene as only your mercies can. Help us not only reach for your hand, O God, help us be your hands. Thank you for believing in us. Thank you for transforming us. Thank you for teaching us even how to pray when words fail us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us say together our benediction. God is our refuge against the things that confound us, and God also helps those affected by our sins. Let us be patient, let us love our neighbor, and let us remember that God loves us. Get up, take heart. Jesus is still calling you. Go and remember. Amen. Christ bears your burdens and your fears, so even in the midst of tears, sing praises, alleluia. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.